We do need to talk a little bit about the Los Angeles Lakers in this situation here, because we're getting a lot of questions in the chat, of course, asking about them and what this means. I mean, they were expected to be the third team in a Knicks-Jazz deal. So now you've got Colin Sexton surprisingly going to the Cavs. You've got a bunch of picks and things like that going back to the Jazz. Where does this leave the Lakers? And maybe it also includes the Knicks in this. Does this leave the Lakers and the Knicks and all these other teams just kind of scrambling to reassess what the trade market looks like? Or where does LA go from here?
Let me do the Knicks part first, because I think that part's easier. I think the Knicks are just, all right, we have our team. And now they just move on. I don't think the Knicks are good. There's no one else to turn to for them. I don't think that necessarily makes sense for them to get to. Woj had a follow-up tweet that the Knicks, and excuse me, I'm getting the hiccups. I'm so excited, Trevor. the Knicks had re-engaged with the Cavs. The Knicks declined a trade deal on Monday night, which is when the Cavs jumped back in. Mm-hmm. So with the Knicks, my guess is they just say, all right, we've got our team. The Lakers, this is where it gets a little interesting, because obviously we've had the rumors for, it feels like, you know, 2 months of Russ to the Pacers floating out there. At least we're getting close to that, at least timing-wise. Then we've also had this thought of them being the third team in. They would maybe take on, like, Evan Fournier from the Knicks and then take on a couple of the veteran guys from the Jazz. So I think we're in a position where the Jazz stuff still open, right? The Knicks aren't going to get involved now. But you could still go get a couple of those Jazz vets. You could get Conley and Bogdanovich. I'm just, you know, making it, throwing numbers at work out there. You could still do something like that. And obviously, there's still the Pacers possibility for the Lakers. I think a lot of it hinges on, do they want to give up both 27 and 29? If they want to give up both picks, I think they'll get a deal done. I think they could get a deal done probably today, either the Pacers deal or the Jazz deal. I just don't think they're in a position where right now they feel the right move today, September 1st, is the day to trade two first-round picks for whether it be Miles Turner and Buddy Hield or a collection of veterans from the Jazz.
What's your take on the rumor that the Pacers were asking the Lakers to also take back the contract of Daniel Tice? How much does that negatively impact the value of that deal from the Lakers' perspective?
If I was the Lakers and I was willing to do Russ and two firsts for Turner and Hield, I would not let having to take Daniel Tice keep me from doing that. That almost feels like, I'm not going to do this deal that gets me two really nice players because you're trying to throw in the third. Tice's contract's not that bad. It's like $9 million the next couple of seasons. So it's not ideal, but if you're taking on Turner and Hield, along with LeBron already being extended, AD's contract, you're capped out. You're not going to be a salary cap player. So why not have Tice? He's still a useful backup center. I know now they've got, that would give them Bryant.
That would give them five centers. Exactly. Essentially. That's the problem. It's more a roster construction.
But next year you could let Jones and Bryant move on. Tice also, if nothing else, that becomes $9 million of salary matching that works in another trade. If you're like, you know, boy, we could really use another wing with size at the trade deadline, put Tice with Lonnie Walker. If he's not working out, you have $15 million that goes and gets you a $20 million player salary matching wise. So it wouldn't keep me from making the trade. I certainly wouldn't be excited about it.
Yeah.
I also don't know if I'm the Pacers that I would say, all right, well, we'll do Russ in one pick. If you also take Tice back, then that seems almost a little too imbalanced that way. I would probably just say, just leave him out, Indiana. Figure it out yourself with him.
Yeah.
And then you move on with, Russ and picks. And I mean, Russ goes to Indiana or Utah. I doubt he even reports there. I think it's probably more of the, hey, we did it. Thanks for your service. Hang out till we work a buyout or an additional trade or whatever direction they collectively choose to go in.
Where would he report?
That's a good question. right? Yeah, I don't know.
Who would realistically trade for him that would then put him on the floor?
Yeah, it's tough. There it is. There's the question I feel like we've been asking for 5 months plus. I think it just becomes, yeah, I think it's, you know, wait it out and then see. For him, honestly, you probably wait it out a little bit and then see, or where did a point guard get hurt? And sure, then, all right, hey, I'm here, I'm ready to go. And, you know, then maybe a team's, you know, willing to jump on him.
Woj just tweeted that Utah has coveted veteran trade assets, including Bojan Bogdanovic, Jordan Clarkson, Mike Conley Jr. I like that he were used through the word coveted in there. Let's
confirmed, you know, Woj watching the front office show.
That's right. That's right.
Off us here. So appreciate that, Woj. Shout out.
So yeah, that's so thank you for that. Shout out there, Woj. We appreciate that. But I think the Lakers are now in an interesting spot where they're going to have to reassess the entire trade market because this is going to catch everybody by surprise. The Knicks are going to do the same thing. Now, I think the Knicks, I think you're right. I think ultimately they probably just stick with what they've got. Yep. But teams around the NBA are going to react to this. They're going to respond, and they're going to figure out their path forward from here. And the path forward may just be the status quo. It might be you just stick with what you've got. It also might be, hey, who knows? If the Lakers were planning on being a third team in a Knicks-Jazz deal and that no longer exists, does that then increase some leverage in terms of the Pacers side and a deal there? Do you turn to the Jazz and still work something out there for some of these pieces that Woj is talking about? I think there's still opportunities to move Russell Westbrook, but you're still stuck with that ultimate question of, do you want to give up both first? And if not, then who blinks? Do the Lakers blink and give up both first? Or do the Pacers, the Jazz, whoever else wants to get involved, do they blink and finally say, well, okay, we'll do a first in 2 seconds or something like that?
Yeah, if you're the Pacers and Jazz, you're just waiting on the Lakers to get desperate and hoping that happens, right? You're hoping the first opening days of training camp come with a report of really uncomfortable training camp with, you know, the Lakers, you know, and you're just hoping for that. You know, ideally you're hoping that desperation comes anytime between now and the next 3 weeks, you know, roughly when training camp's open. But yeah, but you would love to see that, because what you're hoping for is they obviously you want the Lakers to give up both firsts and in a trade. It's interesting. I think there are trade constructions that would work that I feel like could make an awful lot of sense for the Lakers to give up both firsts. I very much understand their hesitation to do so. I just, you know, you and I talked about this on a previous episode of Front Office Show. I tend to think you're built to win right now with the core of this team. And I don't want to sacrifice any of that chance at winning right now. Yeah. For what may come down the line. I just, you know, we'll see, you know, where they feel about that. But that's just, I don't know. I feel like when you're this close, but also, as we talked about, it's not like either one of those deals, a bunch of good, solid role players from the Jazz or Turner and Hield, couple, I think just call it what it is, good role players from the Pacers. No all-stars are coming back
right
in this, these trade constructions. How high does that lift you in the West? Does that put you in the tier with the Warriors, Suns, Nuggets, Clippers? I don't think so. I think you're just probably one tier below, but you're almost kind of like what the Cavs did here. You're right there, and then you're one of the next teams up. And maybe by the time the playoffs roll around, you've melded, you've come together, and then you're in that position. But it's that's the hard thing. There's not a slam dunk trade where it's like, all right, West favorites, done. You know, off we go. Because if there was, I think then you definitely trade both first round picks.
Oh, for sure. And that's why we had heard the Lakers were willing to do it for Kyrie Irving, because that was seen as more of that kind of slam dunk trade. But we'll see how exactly the Lakers respond to this, as well as how the rest of the NBA responds.